Welcome to Worship at Christ Church Presbyterian. We're grateful you decided to be here with us, and we hope you'll be encouraged as you participate in today's service. So join with us now as Pastor Robbie Hendrick leads us in worship of the one true and living God.
Thank you, Cathie and Sue. That was lovely. Welcome back, everyone. Good to see all of your shiny faces here for this Thanksgiving service tonight. We have all kind of announcements. I'm going to go through them really, really quick. They all have a form so that we're making it easy for you. Capital campaign, tithes and offerings, poinsettia, elder nominations, deacon nominations. There's some things that we don't have forms for, and here they are. The Christmas dinner, December the 5th. It is also our love gift offering. There's going to be, we're going to have a dinner. We're going to have singing of hymns. We're going to have kids singing. It's going to be fun. And this is also the time that we make donations, annual donations for our missionaries. So we make a love gift contribution to each one of them at the end of each year that is very helpful to them and encouraging to them as well. Also, Palmer Home. If you would like to make a donation to the Palmer Home, this is a ministry that we've been involved with for all the way back to WW2. And it's a great ministry. It's an orphanage for children, and they have a couple of locations. You can read about them in the bulletin. You can put a donation in the offering plate tonight. If you don't have a means of doing that this evening, you can send something in to the church office during the week. Okay. Did I get through all of those okay? So tonight we're going to have a devotional from Robbie, and then in just a little bit, I'm kind of planting the seed so you can be thinking about this, you will have the opportunity to speak to everyone via this microphone up here about something that you are thankful for, something that's happened to you maybe this year that you would like to just express yourself that you're thankful for. If you don't come forward, we're going to start pulling you out of the pew, and then we'll drag you up to the microphone. No, I'm just kidding. We aren't going to do that. If you feel the urge and the desire to do that, we'll love to hear from you. Our call to worship this evening is taken from Psalm 57:5. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be all over the earth. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you because of who you are and how you have called us to yourself, that you have made that call irresistible, and that you have gathered us together as a people of God, brothers and sisters, and children who seek to be together in worship. We pray that our worship this evening would be acceptable in your sight. We invite you to hear to be here, to be with us, and that your spirit would be among this congregation as we worship. We pray and ask in Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to take your Trinity hymnals, 363, we gather together to ask the Lord's blessings. Let's stand to sing.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer together. Thank you, Lord, that we are gathered here this evening to sing praises to you. We are thankful to you for our salvation, that you have called us to yourself. We thank you for those who you have used in our past. Each one individually here has been influenced by parents, friends, neighbors to hear from your word and to hear the call of Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you have allowed us to hear your call and that you have called us to yourself. We pray, Lord, that we would be found worthy of brothers and sisters and children in Christ in all that we do and say. We thank you, Lord, for your word. We're thankful that it is convincing in our lives. We thank you for all the promises that are in your word and that you knew us before we were even born, that neither death nor life nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, any powers can separate us from you. We thank you for the great comfort that that brings. And we ask, Lord, that you would remind us of that truth. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to be still and to know that you are our God and that we are your people. Remind us, Lord, to ask you for wisdom, for we all need it, especially in these days and times. Calm us when everyday alarms are going off all around us. Remind us, Lord, that you are sovereign, that you are sovereign and that nothing takes you by surprise. Make us sensitive to the needs of others. Give us a burden for those who are outside of Christ. Spur us on to words of encouragement to each other, for we all have burdens that only you are even aware of. Remind us, Lord, that we are created for your own purpose, and that is to glorify you and to enjoy you forever. May we always be a thankful people, grateful for everything that comes from your generous hand. And as we gather with family and with friends this week, may we reflect on another year of your marvelous grace and give all praise and glory and honor to you. And we pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Jesus, my Lord, my God, my all, hear me, blessed Savior, when I call. Hear me, and from thy dwelling place pour down the riches of thy grace. Jesus, too late I thee have sought. How can I love thee as I ought? And how extol thy matchless babe, the glorious beauty of thy name. Oh, Jesus, my Lord, it's thee I adore. Oh, make me love thee, oh, make me love thee. Jesus, what didst thou find in me that thou hast dealt so lovingly? How great the joy that thou hast brought, so far exceeding hope or thought. Oh, Jesus, my Lord, I adore.
Take your Bibles, if you would, and turn to Psalm 57. Psalm 57. We're going to spend about 10 minutes in Psalm 57, and then we're going to open up the mic to allow all of us to really share what the Lord has been doing in our life this year, which I'm grateful for. Give us a couple of minutes to do just that. Let me read Psalm 57. Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me, for in you my soul takes refuge. In the shadow of your wings I will take refuge till the storms of destruction pass by. I cry out to God Most High, to God who fulfills his purpose for me. He will send from heaven and save me. He will put to shame him who tramples on me. God will send out his steadfast love and his faithfulness. My soul is in the midst of lions. I lie down among fiery beasts and children of man whose teeth are spears and arrows, whose tongues are sharp swords. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all of the earth. They set a net for my steps. My soul was bowed down. They dug a pit in my way, but they have fallen into it themselves. My heart is steadfast, O God, my heart is steadfast. I will sing and make melody. Awake my glory. Awake, O harp and lyre. I will awake the dawn. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. For your steadfast love is great to the heavens and your faithfulness to the clouds. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all of the earth. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful to be able to close out the Lord's day together and to focus upon your greatness and your goodness to us. Lord, as we prepare even this week for kind of a different week, a week of Thanksgiving, we pray that, Lord, you would be the focus of all of that and that we would give thanks and praise to you for each and every moment. And Lord, be with us even tonight. Open the scriptures to us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. There's a small story behind this. Our deacons serve so faithfully every week, and they bring water to me. And I looked up here a while ago, and Billy's up here drinking my water. So he has brought me some more. Thank you. Thank you. Well, it has been an interesting year, and I don't think that it's over yet. There's a lot going on in the world around us. There's a lot going on even in our nation. As you've read your bulletin, there's a lot going on in the life of the church. And I think we are going to be continuing in this for quite some time. I don't think it's going away anytime soon. What do we do when we are faced with things that are happening like we see today? How do we get our minds focused back upon the Lord? I think David, who wrote this psalm, gives us a great example here. He is actually in a cave running from Saul, who is trying to kill him. And what we see in this psalm in just a few verses is that he confesses his situation to God, and then he celebrates God, giving him praise and thanksgiving. Let's jump in real quick. Roman numeral number one, we see the distress of David. He confesses his situation to God. Here's what we see. He starts by crying out for mercy. Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me until the storms of destruction pass by. Now, what are these storms in David's life? We know that he is now sleeping in a cave. We know that he's running for his life from Saul. We know that he is running from not just Saul, but all of his enemies. We know, at least in verse 4, these enemies are called lions or fiery beasts whose teeth are spears and arrows and tongues are sharp swords. The Bible says that they are setting a net for him, trying to trap him. And verse 6 even says that they've dug a pit for him in order to catch him. Let's face it, David at this moment in time is not in a great place. And the first thing that he does is confess that to the Lord. Now listen carefully, he doesn't confess that because he doesn't think the Lord doesn't know. It's not because God does not know the predicament that David is in, but because it is the first step towards a heart of thanksgiving. Let me say that again so that it registers. Confessing where we are is the first step towards a heart of thanksgiving. Really? Confessing the horrible situation that we are in is the first step to a heart of thankfulness? That doesn't sound right. And yet that's what we see in Psalm 57. Watch what happens. That confession of distress in David's situation is bookended by a description of God and a complete delight in him. What do we see in verse 1? He says, the shadow of your wings. God is the protector. You know what that means? Even in the midst of a cold cave, I am secure. Verse 2, he calls him God Most High, Almighty, All-Powerful. Verse 2, God who fulfills his purpose for me. We know that God is sovereign over my life and over everything that happens in my life. You know what that means to me? That even in a cave, I can rest. Verse 3, he sends from heaven and saves me. God is the author of my salvation, and because of his sovereignty, because of the fact that he is almighty, he is also not just the quote-unquote author of my salvation, but also the sustainer of it. And you know what that does? That gives me great peace in the midst of what I'm walking through. Verse 3, put to shame him who tramples on me. Listen, God is my victor. He is the one who conquered death and hell and Satan. And you know what that means for me? It means I can be content. Verse 3, sends steadfast love and faithfulness. You see how he's walking through how God is almighty and powerful and sovereign and loving. There's the relational piece. God loves me and is faithful to his people. And then he calls him in verse 9, Lord, God is my ruler, my king, protecting his kingdom and keeping me safe in it. He references him as ruler and king even in the passage. David is in great distress at the moment. He begs for mercy. He confesses his situation, but continues to practice the description of who God is in his life the entire time that he is sitting in the cave. Protector, all-powerful, sovereign, author of my salvation, victor, loving, faithful, ruler, king. And as he continues to practice who God is in his mind, the thing that bursts out of his heart is thankfulness. He shows great delight in God. Notice that it's every other verse, 5, 7, 9, and 11. You see, here's the deal. David in his mind is saying that because you are my protector and all-powerful and sovereign and the author of my salvation and my victor, and you love me and you're faithful to me and you are my ruler and king, therefore, verse 5, be exalted, O God, above the heavens, and let your glory be over all of the earth. In fact, when he thinks through this description of who God is in verses 1 through 4, it seems like he is so moved by it that he doesn't just say this once. He actually says it twice. He can't help himself because there is this moment where he is just thankful for who God is and what he has done in his own life as he is sitting in this cave to the point where he is overwhelmed by God's goodness. And so he says it again, not just in verse 5, but in verse 11. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Two times. And in between these two bookends of professing exaltation, David says in verse 7, my heart is steadfast, O God. My heart is steadfast. I will sing and make melody. And then in verse 9, he says, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. Here's what David is saying. I refuse to let what I'm walking through deter from your glory. And though times are tough, I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings. I know the storm will pass. If not in this life, then at least in the life to come. I have that guarantee. And I know that God will fulfill his purpose for me, and regardless of the road that he has asked me to walk, I will praise his name. For I know that his steadfast love is great to the heavens, and his faithfulness to the clouds. I will give praises to you because of who you are and because of what you've done. And if you're calling me to walk the road of disappointment and pain, then, oh God, be exalted in that too. Because even then, I will give thanks to you. Let your glory be over all the earth. We gather tonight to simply give thanks to God. I don't think any of us are living in a cave right now, but we have a lot of reason to give praise to God for what he has done this year. And we want to open up the mic and let you share that with all of us. And so the mic is down front. I would invite you to come up. Let me give you just a couple of parameters. First of all, you know, be fairly brief. I mean, I know you want to tell your story, and I want you to tell your story, but we hope that there's more than one that wants to do that. Number two, if only one does that, then you need to feel like God is prompting you at this moment to get up and do that too. Just a little bit of a, you know, an urgent nudge if you need it. But we're going to spend some time just celebrating the Lord and his goodness. And so the mic is here. Come up at your leisure. If you would like to share a Thanksgiving story, just come on up to the mic. And I do hope that many do come and share, because we do have a lot to be thankful for.
Because of my age and the fact that I just recently underwent chemo, my immune system may be compromised. I have a daughter and a daughter-in-law who work in the hospital, and we babysit our grandchildren twice a week. So we were really open to possibly contracting COVID, which could be bad for us. My daughter-in-law was twice in the company of someone who tested positive. But she did not get it. She tested negative. Our son from Memphis was coming to visit, and just days before they were going, they found out that at their grandmother's funeral, her brother had tested positive for COVID. So the whole family had to be tested. Praise the Lord, they were negative, and they came. A week ago Friday, William called at 11 o'clock. I'm coming to pick up the kids. My boss tested positive for COVID, and he was in the office Monday and Tuesday. Again, we prayed, and again, he tested negative. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever and ever. Amen.
I want to thank God for this church. You have been so supportive of me and taking care of me during the last few years. Gloria reminded me, she was up there singing. She, a few days before Rick passed away, she came to the door and she said, God wanted me to sing to Rick. So she had her hymn book, and she, without music or anything, she stood there and sang. And it was such a blessing. It reminds me of that. But you guys have taken care of my car. You've made sure that I've had fellowship and gone out to eat with you. So many of you. I just, too many people to even think about naming. But you guys know who you are. And, you know, God has been so real to me. And I have spent many hours, sometimes hours during the day, memorizing God's word, and it has just been so real to me. And when things have become overwhelming, not only in the world, but missing my dear husband and his family situation, God has reminded me in Colossians that we are supposed to set a mind on things above, not on things on the earth. And that has helped me so much. And then further down in that chapter, it says, and let the peace of God rule in your heart. And, you know, when things get bad, we have to let God rule in our hearts And if we don't, you know, God's peace won't be there. But as we set our mind on Him and not on the things that are happening on the earth, God's peace can rule in our hearts. And I want to thank you. I love you guys so very much.
Well, I think this has been an interesting year for all of us. And I'm thankful for faith, for family, for friends, for this church. For me, it's been an interesting year. I practiced medicine for 50 years, and this year got to be on the other side of the equation. I was diagnosed as a lymphoma, having a lymphoma in December, and so I've been through chemo this year. I've had a lot of good doctors. I've had an interesting time with chemo. I'm sure that those of us that have had it all have had similar reactions. But I thank God that I had a diagnosis made. I've had good medical care, and I've responded well so far to my medication. So every now and then, the good Lord slaps us upside the head and says, you know, you need to pay attention. Well, I got my slap on the side of the head. So I, you know, for all of us, I think we just have so, so much to be thankful for. So praise God.
I'm kind of like Charles. The Lord works in mysterious ways and does slap us up along the side of the head. But 2 years ago, my chronic cough was diagnosed, and my shortness of breath, as being caused by pulmonary fibrosis. And this is, you know, a reason why I found out. Yvonne said, why are you always puffing if you walk up and down a flight of stairs? But I do thank the Lord that the doctor said, we can stop this scarring in your lungs by prescribing this medicine for you. Now, there's only one problem. The medicine cost about $10,000 a month. So that was shocking to me. I know Medicare Part D and things like this have these donut holes and thresholds you have to meet. Well, I learned all about that. And at the end of the year, out of my pocket, I had spent over $11,000 or $12,000, about $1,000 a month for this drug. And I mentioned this to John Oliver, and he said, well, the Lord owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. He'll take care of you. Well, I do trust in the Lord. I've investigated, you know, what means I had to be compensated for this. And there are a lot of hoops to jump through, but there's a program the government had for atomic energy workers. And about 35 years ago, I happened to be in a room that was contaminated with plutonium, and I inhaled plutonium. And when they analyzed my urine and did chest x-rays and whole body counts, found out that I had had a previous exposure. I had not only had plutonium-238, but 239. And folks used to joke with my wife, saying she doesn't need a nightlight because I could just sit there and be glowing beside her. But anyway, I want to just say that, praise the Lord, I did qualify for this program. Three quarters of my expenses have been paid for my drugs. I do this, want to give God the glory for this. I'm reminded of the prayers, you have not because you ask not. And we ask for His glory and for His purposes. So I thank the Lord for that and for so many, many other things. I can look down my life and just see, you know, when things are going out of control, God had a purpose for it, and sometimes you have to look back and see, yeah, he was keeping us like he kept David in the cave. So praise to God and to his glory. Amen.
We probably all have friends who haven't been to church since the beginning of March. I was talking to a friend just last week who said, there's not any music at my church. We're not allowed to have music at my church, so what's the point of going? Now, to me, that means she needs to be listening to Robbie, because Robbie is good. Even without music, he's a reason to come to church. He preaches the Word of God strongly every time. But the music speaks to us, and I'm thankful that this church, that the elders have pushed to open up, and that we are having choir now, and we're having brass, if I do say so myself, and hymn singing, and so even for me, even if the choir was singing and we had brass, the hymns were missing. So it's nice to be in a church that is kind of, I guess, pushing the limit to get fully opened again, because I believe that this COVID thing is from Satan, and we need to push back against it. And we need to not only ask God to get rid of it and to work in the midst of it, but expect it to happen, not just ask. So I'm thankful for this church, the elders who are leading us through it, and the growth of this church. We've seen the growth of this church during this year. So I thank God for all of that.
I'm one of the new ones in the church. Even though you may have seen my face around here for the last 2 years, we were wintering here, or summering here, and wintering, and no, the other way around. Got out of Montana in the wintertime and came south. Well, COVID caught us, and a few other things was going on, and we went ahead and made the leap and became members. Like everybody else has said, I thank God for this church. Rick Hammond's one of the reasons I'm here. So are you. Ken and his wife were the first ones to say hi outside of Faye Dill. Made us feel so much at home immediately. We lived in Goshen, 28 miles to come. Now we live in Trenton, South Carolina. We're moving closer, I think. But the bottom line is, God has worked so many miracles in so many ways. And I see it in this body all the time. And it just amazes me to watch it. Now, I don't know where God has in store for me and my wife. We've gotten older, we've gotten slower, and we can't do what we used to do in the church, so we're finding a new something. And I know one of the things that I'm led to is really people helping people, members helping members. I worked on my degree in biblical counseling, and thanks to working with Robbie, we now have some information out front, and we're working on just that. God's word is sufficient for all of our needs. And so in member helping member, I guess I'm going to be one of the new faces. I don't know how that's going to work out, but I trust in God, and I know that God will make it work. And I think it's just great to see a body of Christians that have opened up the way this church has, even though when they said they were closing, I got real mad. How dare you step outside God's will? Then I had to come under submission to the session.
That's before I was a member. But all of that is part of the way God makes us grow through the crisis. And I'm still growing, just slower. But do praise God for all of that and thank Him greatly.
Now you go, Billy. Lay down.
One of the advantages of being at the front, most people don't like to be up front looking out, but you get to see people coming in during, you know, as the service is beginning. And we talked about growth. I see three new members, the Purcells, the Calderwoods, and Rich. Melanie must be working, but she's not here. I mean, that's three new members we have interviewed. I tell people it's my favorite part of the job of being an elder is interviewing new members, because we've had, I don't know how many, maybe 20 or so or new members. So I'm thankful for them. Is Stephanie still up there in the balcony? Are you back? Maybe? No, not permanently. Thank you, and thank Gloria for that song. That was wonderful. And by the way, where's Joseph Doss? Joseph, how old is Joseph? Seven? Ten. Have y'all heard that cello? That was him. It was a 10-year-old. And it reminded me of the talent that we have in this church, the musical talent. It's amazing. If you haven't seen these kids play, you need to come to every night service, because sometimes they'll play. And it's just absolutely incredible. And then every once in a while you hear a little baby cry. We got babies all over the place. I'm not going to try to name who all of them are, because I don't know who they are. But there are some amazing things going on at this church. We've been talking about it in session meetings, that we're right on the cusp, right on the edge of God doing some amazing things here. And I really believe that. And I'm so that's what I'm thankful for, and look forward to maybe a better 2021 next year than we had here in 2020, where we're all uninterruptedly meeting morning and evening. So that's it. Thanks. Gloria, come on up.
First of all, I want to thank the congregation for praying for my sister and her husband this year during their extremely traumatic move from Colorado to Oklahoma. My sister said she never really understood the power of prayer. And she said when people ask me to pray, she'd say, oh, yeah. And now she says, yeah. So thank you very much. I also want to mention that I am very grateful for Derek Smith's and his leading the class, The Way of the Master. Meets Sunday mornings during Sunday school, and it's the most powerful evangelistic tool I have ever encountered in my life. The next time he offers this, attend it. It's the way Jesus used the gospel to convict people of sin. It bypasses the intellect and goes straight into the person's conscience, and it is amazing. So part of this class is to challenge us to share the gospel. Well, I have a very close friend who's from China. I know she's not a believer. I've been spending a lot of time with her, and so I've been very convicted. I'm terrified. I don't know how to. This is so frightening. So I said, God, I'm such a poor vessel, but it's your strength, not mine. It's not me. I can't do it. So I said, okay, God, I'm a major chicken. You need to provide an opportunity that is so blatant that I can't resist. So yesterday I was out with her driving around for 2 hours in the car. And when I got in the car, here she's playing Dolly Parton's latest Christmas album, all about Jesus, the babe. And I'm like, boom. Whoa. So I waited until we were gonna be driving for some time, and I said, do you know why Christians get so excited and celebrate Christmas so much? This was an opportunity you could drive a truck through. And so I didn't know how much she knew about Christianity, but I shared the basic plan. And since yesterday, I have been so filled with joy. It's amazing. Now, I could tell she wasn't convicted, but I also didn't use the way of the master approach. I kind of just did your typical plan of salvation. Here's how it works. But I'm going to pray and ask God to give me another opportunity and to continue, because I feel like he's calling me to bring her, to use me to bring her into the family of Christ. So thank you for this. Is kind of a long story. Thank you.
Well, first off, let me say we're grateful that you allowed us to be a part of the fellowship of the church, and I hope you don't have buyer's remorse. But let me kind of, more in a lighthearted way, share something that I think gave me a multitude of things to say thank you to the Lord for, and it has to do with a tree, my neighbor's tree. It's gone. Yay. Now, let me tell you the background of that. 28 years ago, we moved here into a new development, and at the same time, we had our next-door neighbors moved in the same time, and they were the Adams family, okay? The real Adams family, and they're nothing like the people that you see on TV. Matter of fact, they were Presbyterians. But anyway, Brian, like so many people, when they go to plant trees, they like to plant them as close to their neighbor's border as they possibly can. So Brian plants and don't realize that little trees turn into big trees. Now, Brian has since long moved away. But anyway, this tree is close to my property, very close, near our driveway, near our garage. 28 years later, this tree is over 50 feet high. It has a humongous canopy, and every fall we have the blessing of all the leaves and the chestnuts that are the size of a walnut that pelt you when you're walking in that part. And if your car is out there in the driveway, they're taking a beating. This tree is growing toward my house. So I never cursed this tree, but I did not pray for its long life and prosperity. So this past spring, you know, we had some unusual weather, and we had a big windstorm that came up. I'm out in the front part of the yard. Our car is in the driveway. I go, you know what? I think I better go ahead and pull this car in. Pull the car in, go into the house. I walk down to the other end of the house, and my wife is calling me to come back. The tree has fallen. The tree has fallen across the driveway, where the car was that I was in 30 seconds earlier. So the rest of this is Georgia law. Neighbor's tree falls on your property, it is your tree. Homeowner's insurance will not cover a tree. It depends on where it falls. If it just falls on your property. So here's where everything comes together. Okay, my neighbor comes over, and a few other neighbors too, because here's this big tree. And so as it all works out, because the tree fell on my driveway and I can't get out of my garage, my insurance helps pay for it. My neighbor, who does not have to help pay for this tree, graciously pays for the other half that I couldn't cover. And of course, the Lord has blessed, and we had money set aside for these types of events. So that's covered. So, okay, the tree is taken care of, and we can't get out of the garage with our cars. First thing next morning, the tree removal people come, they cut this up. So we have all that to be thankful for, Plus, it did not hit the house. It did not crack my driveway. I was not in the car, and it didn't hit the car. So in a life event that I'm very grateful that this tree is gone, in the dramatic way that the Lord took this, not big problem, but, you know, an annoyance out of my life, but the many things I had to be thankful for the way it was paid for, the way it was removed, and no damage done, and delivered from harm's way. So thank you, Lord.
Hi, my name is Gracie, and we live in Georgia, and I'm thankful for God and the world that He has provided for us.
Just like to say, we are very thankful to God. We've moved several times in the last few years, and He's just prepared such a wonderful home for us here and a church family that we were able to just move into and settle in and feel like we had a family and support. So thank you all.
Hi, my name is Ben, and I'm 9 years old, and I'm thankful for being great at sports and being really fast, because one time in Texas, a bee tried to sting me on the shoulder, on my left shoulder. My right hand shot up, like, really fast and whacked a bee. It barely skinned me. I'm thankful for God to giving me the speed so I could protect myself, and that's it.
There's going to be a lot of opportunity for us this week to be able to share our thankfulness to the Lord with each other as we travel and as people travel to see us. I hope that is true for all of us. I will say, Philip, that I have actually moved a car in a windstorm, but it was up under a tree, not away from one, and it never worked out for me. The tree never fell on the car that I was wanting to get rid of. But, you know, God is still good, and it all worked out. Yeah. Tell you a quick story. There's always an opportunity for us to share. As with so many other families, whenever we get together on Thanksgiving, I will look around the room and look at our family and just simply ask a question. Tell me one or two things that you're thankful for. Typically, by the time we get done, and of course we do have a larger family, but by the time we get done, the food is getting cold. Because once you begin to start talking about how good God is, you just can't stop. And that is just the truth of the goodness of God in our lives. And I hope that's true for us. I am very thankful for this family. I love the fact that we can get together as a family and do this type of thing. I love the fact that people that were just introduced today are willing to stand and share their heart. And I'm thankful for children who have the bravery really to stand and to say, I'm thankful for something. And I'm thankful for this church and all that it means to me and my family and how this has been, and I've said this before, a good, safe, soft landing for us. And it's been really, really good. So I just appreciate all that you guys do for my family, and thank you for that. We are going to sing Count Your Blessings as we close out this evening. And so Stan, come on up and lead us.
And it's in the family song collection, 101. 101. Let's stand to sing.
And now receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace both now and forevermore. And all of God's people said, amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us for worship at Christ Church Presbyterian. We're grateful that you were able to take part in worship with us, and we hope that the time you've spent here has been an encouragement to you. Please remember to stay in touch, and if there's something you need or something you'd like for us to lift up in prayer, call us at 706-210-9090. Of course, please continue to pray for each other and for those who lead us, that they would seek God in their decisions. And don't forget to come back again to our website, myccp.faith, or the Christ Church Facebook page to be a part of worship at Christ Church Presbyterian.